Obrigada, gente. Para mim, pelo menos, esse vídeo suscita um monte de perguntas e dúvidas e questionamentos até. Acho que tem muita coisa para a gente colocar aqui. Eu vou abrir o Slido, e aí tem uma senha que eu não sei. A senha, no caso. Posso tentar. Não, a senha não do Slido, do computador. Ah, mas eu posso ver aqui. Beleza, obrigada. Então, opa. Vamos lá. A pergunta mais votada, por enquanto, é uma pergunta anônima. Haha. E ela diz o seguinte. Agora eu vou mudar para inglês, tá? Para a Audrey poder responder para a gente. Então, se alguém precisar de tradução simultânea, tem aqui. Fiquem à vontade para buscar. Taiwan is an exception when conservatism and nationalism grow in the world. What are the strategies to make this revolution international and permanent? Hi, Audrey.
Hi there. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yes, that's great. Thank you for the
wonderful
questions.
Yeah. Answer the question.
Right, so we'll get right into it. As of the strategies, what I've discovered is that the smaller the region is, the easier it is to start introducing techniques like this. So, for example, my mother was recently elected as the chief counselor of her neighborhood council, and that's like less than like 200 people or 300 people. And so it's very easy to use both face-to-face and online tools in complement with each other when you start introducing techniques like this. But for regional issues, for city issues, it's a little bit harder. It's like participatory budgeting. But for national issues, abstract issues, that's even harder because you essentially have to carry feelings from one region to another region, right? So the idea, I think, is to start small, to celebrate small successes. And once people get their feeling changed, it's just like in our hackathons, we always provide very delicious food in association with this kind of methodology. It's not to change people's procedures overnight. It's to change their feelings toward such processes. And so once people's fear, uncertainty, and doubt gets lowered by small-scale successful experiments, it tends to spread organically than any top-down experiments.
Thank you, Audrey. I'm looking at the questions now, and there's a few that are already here. There's one that I'm particularly interested in, so I'm going to use my prerogative here to bring it to you. Mm-hmm. It's about filter bubbles. Wait a second. I just lost it. Oh, yeah. Could you please explain further how you avoid group polarization dynamics? How do you avoid the filter bubble?
Okay, that's a great question. I think the idea here is to provide online and offline spaces that are safe. For offline places, for face-to-face places, everybody knows what a safe space means, so I will not explain. But for online spaces, safe spaces are those spaces that protect people from each other's replies. So all the platforms that we use, Slido and Polis, as you saw in the recording, as well as the petition platform, everybody can post their ideas, their feelings, but they are not allowed to reply to each other. The only thing they can do when they see something that they don't like is by proposing another feeling or suggestion that gets more resonance than the one that they don't like. So in this kind of method, people compete for resonance with each other, and we highlight the ones that has the most votes, just like Slido here. So it gets, of course, very fancy with Polis, where we see people literally coming from the edges into the middle, but the idea is always the same. You can think of Slido as a one-dimensional Polis, where the more consensus gets to the top. But the idea is that people never reply to each other, they become safe, and they engage with people who are different in opinion by proposing more creative ideas that resonates with more people. So that's the basic design principle. I'm sure that you can think of better user experiences than the three that I mentioned that realize this principle.
Audrey, I have a question from myself, if that's mm-hmm. okay.
Sure.
Vou fazer uma pergunta minha, gente, só para eu ter essa chance. A minha pergunta, my question is, this idea of rough consensus and building resonance, as you mm-hmm. said, is there a danger of isolating dissonance? Mm-hmm. Even if you have rough consensus, it's really hard to get real consensus. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes, the sort of the smallest minorities are the mm-hmm. ones who are disagreeing mm-hmm. with the large majorities. Mm-hmm. How do you take care of protecting minority rights in mm-hmm. that context? Mm-hmm. And how do you ensure that you're not just shutting down the dissonance?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, it's actually two questions that you ask, right? The first question is that the minorities, how do we keep them from being excluded? That's the first one. And the second one is that the minorities, the dissents and so on, once they're made visible, is there a process or a space for them to roughly effectuate their views on the wider group so that everybody agrees on something that everybody can live with? And it requires two different solutions, so I'm going to answer separately. For one, the visibility. The polis interface is deliberately designed so that it represents diversity, not sheer numbers. So on this two-dimensional space, if 500 people come and vote exactly the same, it's just one dot in this two-dimensional space, and another five people has five different opinions that's different from those 500 people, they will nevertheless occupy a larger area than the 500 people that shares the same ideology. So by designing the space, basically inviting stakeholders, but explicitly saying, 100 people with one opinion is just one post-it note, one dot, one Slido line, but five people with dissident views are actually five post-it notes and larger area and five Slido line. It basically says the majority has to nevertheless look at the minority no matter the number. So the solution to the first one is to design the interface, design the procedure to value diversity over the sheer numbers. And the second one, I think, is mostly to allocate sufficient time for every point, be there majority or minority, to fully express themselves and for everybody to listen. So the idea is that people take turns listening to each other, understanding that no decision will happen until every side present their feelings. And so this safe space is also a safe from decision space. Everybody knows that for the next 7 days, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, no decision will happen, and every side has their chance to fully express their feelings. And that's how people integrate.
I like this idea of safe from decision. Mm-hmm. I'll definitely take that with me. One of the questions that is the most popular here on Slido mm-hmm. is on how your work at the Digital Ministry has affected other central government areas. The full question is, visibility and transparency become radical of your presence at the Digital Ministry. Is this fomenting change in other central government areas?
Right. As I understand, it's easier if the central government is just a little bit larger than a city government, right? For example, it's easier in Iceland, in Estonia, or in Singapore, because essentially their central government is just a little bit larger than a city government. And so for those cases, we do have a like online relationship where we share tools and ideas and so on. But for larger countries, usually we work much closer with a city government, such as the Paris City, the Metro City, and more recently, Ontario in Canada, and maybe New York City. So I think it's about the size. It's not about whether it's central, whether it's regional. There's a certain size where this methodology becomes attractive, but still practical.
Okay, and then I'll move on to our last question. Let me just make sure that I'm, yes, okay. So there are a few that are that have the same amount of votes. I think there's one that is particularly interesting, and it's on the role of the community that was participating in the Occupy Sunflower Revolution. That role, what was the role of the open source tech community on that? How did that relationship evolve, and what was the role during the time?
Right. So we're seen as one of the three neutral groups that provides sufficient human right help to all sides during the Occupy. One is the pro bono lawyers who provides legal help no matter which side you're on. And the other is the medical team who provides, you know, medical help no matter which tent you're in. And we're the ones who provide communication services. That is to say, the idea of net neutrality essentially means that we do not filter the messages that we pass through. We offer live streaming, we offer court reporters like stenography and all sort of shared bookmarks, shared facts and things like that without any prejudice of what kind of sites are using those or free Wi-Fi networks and things like that. Our idea is that the more communication there is, the less chance there is for mistake and less chance for conflict to escalate. Because when the facts spreads faster than rumors, there's no place for rumors, and then there's no place for escalation of violence. And so during the 22 days, there's no one missing, no one dead, and generally it's a very peaceful and safe space for discussion over the occupied parliamentary area. I think that's the key reason why it converged is by the shared blessing of the communication, the medical, and the legal teams.
Thank you so much, Audrey. I think we're running out of time, so unfortunately I'll have to wrap up. But thank you so much for taking time off your busy schedule as a minister to talk to us. It's a real pleasure. And we hope that you continue to inspire us with radical experimentation in Taiwan.
Okay. Right away. And I'm recording this anyway, so I'll be posting this recording on YouTube in principle of radical transparency. So thank you so much.
Ok, bye-bye.
Cheers.
Gente, bye. Muito obrigada. Vamos dar uma rodada de aplausos.